Hello, lovely listeners. Today, we will learn about the history and story of surfing. Surfing, that crazy activity where you stand on a board, on water, on a big wave, and you surf it back to the shore. This is, in fact, an ancient activity and holds great spiritual and religious importance for many people, for many cultures around the world, especially in the South Pacific, Hawaii, and the Polynesian Islands. Welcome to Simple English Listening, where you learn English and also learn about the wider world at the same time. I sincerely hope you come across new information in this podcast, new information about the world that you never knew before. It's also a great joy for me, because in researching and writing these episodes, I'm also learning something new. So, let us learn together. Before we grab our surfboard and ride the waves in the oceans of love, if you enjoy this podcast, please subscribe to the channel and hit the bell on YouTube or leave a review on Spotify or Apple, as it helps new people discover this podcast and the wonderful sharing of this knowledge. And don't forget to do the new online worksheet, okay? The online Google quiz that I've carefully prepared with my own hands. I've been a curriculum developer for about 5 years, yeah? So I've put lots of heart into these Google Sheets. I've made it to practice your reading, vocabulary, grammar, reviewing the new vocabulary from this podcast. So either follow the link in the description to get to the Google quiz, it's completely free, or go to, again, www.simpleenglishlistening.com, brand new website, to find the Google quiz. So the new site, www.simpleenglishlistening.com. It's just easy. Name of the podcast.com. Today's worksheet is in B1 level English, so it's an easier intermediate level. And we have 8 new words. The new vocabulary are plank, revere, deity, fearsome, crafting, ritual, concept, and embrace. And the grammar point for today is the second conditional. For example, using if. For example, if I surfed, the gods would be pleased. If the gods were pleased, I would buy a big house, etc. To talk about imaginary situations, pretend situations. That is the grammar point for this month's worksheet. So if I did the worksheet, I would be better at English. Okay? All in today's free worksheet at simpleenglishlistening.com. And guys, I am a curriculum designer, yeah? I've been doing that for about 5 years, so I know all the different kinds of reading questions you get in TOEIC and TOEFL exams, and also in the National Geographic textbooks. It's these styles of question, okay? So it's a beautiful worksheet. Go check it out. Okay, on with the podcast. Now, the reason I was interested in surfing was because I had a moment. Before I left Vietnam last time, rather got kicked out of Vietnam during COVID, the full story is in the previous episode called Leaving Vietnam. So before I got forcibly removed from this country, by the way, I lived in a beautiful city in Vietnam called Da Nang. Now, Da Nang is the surf capital of Vietnam. Many people surf in Da Nang, many expats, many locals. So I thought, well, This will be a fun way to exercise. So I rented a board with this from this super chilled, chilled means like relaxed, this super chilled Japanese guy who owned a surfing shop. And I tried it. I tried surfing. And the result is I fell in love. I fell in love with it. Before I knew it, I was doing it once, twice, three times per week. Before every session, I'd diligently watch different videos on YouTube of how to improve my technique. Yeah, at this, at that, at popping up, at staying balanced on the board, at swimming out to the waves. And when you're out there, just sitting on your board, waiting for the next wave, you go into a different mind state. It's quite therapeutic, quite a meditative mind state. Meditative, adjective meaning like a meditation. You are very extremely present in the present moment, just waiting for the next wave. Your thoughts come and your thoughts go. Is this the wave? No, not this one. Is this next wave the wave for me? No, not this one. And all other thoughts. Does my girlfriend still like me? Is the laundry finished? What should I have for lunch? I need to send little Timmy a birthday present. All of these thoughts, the thoughts of everyday life, all these thoughts become quieter. And they are replaced with something more natural. The sounds of the waves. The sound of the waves and the seabirds. You notice the light, the beautiful light sparkling on the water. The sun bouncing off the water. The beauty of the green mountain in the distance. You come out of inside your head, and your focus becomes more on what's outside of you, in the present moment, in nature. I can definitely see how this could be related to religion and spirituality in some cultures, being out there on the surfboard. It had a deep effect on myself, and that's just the first part, okay? So that's the first mind state in surfing. The next mind state is when the actual wave comes. And in that moment, when the wave comes, you are definitely not thinking about sending little Timmy a birthday present, nor about your girlfriend. You are 100% intensely present. As you stand up on the board, not a single thought goes through your head. Your mind is completely silent, but at the same time, all the water and splashing and chaos and this huge, enormous strength lifts you up. The infinite strength and power of the ocean, the power of Neptune, of Poseidon, the power of God joins you for a dance. And it takes two people to tango, does it not? In surfing, it's you and God, or the universe, or the raw energy of Earth, or whatever you want to call it. So the act of surfing is like a time when you connect, to this, immense power of the universe. And it's like doing a dance with this unimaginary force of nature. Force is a synonym for power, this force. Now, I can definitely see how this can be seen as a spiritual or religious experience for some cultures, and for me included. Surfing was born in Polynesia more than 1,000 years ago. Polynesia is all these small islands in the South Pacific Ocean, like northeast of Australia, east of the Philippines is kind of where Polynesia begins. Islands such as Tonga, Samoa, Hawaii, Tuvalu. Imagine the setting for the Disney movie Moana, yeah? That tribal island lifestyle. Early surfers rode wooden boards, boards made of wood. No fancy designs or high-tech materials in these cultures. Surfing was more than just a sport. It was also a part of their religion and also society. The people believed that the gods could be pleased by skilled surfers. So, surfing was seen as a way to connect with this divine. Different types of surfboards were used by different classes of people. For example, common people used smaller boards, while chiefs and other high-ranking people used bigger, longer surfboards. Guys, remember, the best learning is to listen to this podcast multiple times. Listen to it again, maybe two or three times if you can, because you will absorb more language that way, and you will naturally pick up English more. Okay, so in these societies, surfing was also used to solve disagreements and conflicts. Instead of fighting, they would have a surf contest. Contest means competition. Well, so when they'd have disagreements, they'd have a surf contest, and the winner would be considered correct or right. The first Westerners to see surfing were European explorers. They were amazed by the Polynesian skill and balance on the waves. These explorers brought the idea of surfing back to Europe, and from there, it eventually spread all over the world. Today, we can still see the influence of these early Polynesian cultures in modern surfing. Just look at the designs on surf clothing and boards. The designs you see on clothes by such brands as Quiksilver, Billabong, you can certainly see Polynesian influence there. Well, I can, anyways. Here's a funny fact for you, an anecdote, a funny little story. Ancient Hawaiians believed that the best surfer in the village had the power to ward off sharks. So to scare off sharks, so to keep sharks away from the village and to keep their people safe from them. Kind of puts you under pressure, doesn't it? What happens if you're the best surfer and then a village kid gets eaten by a shark? Yeah? Ruined reputation, at the least. Anyway, ancient Hawaiians believed that riding a wave could help them communicate with the gods. This kind of links to what I was saying in my own experience, right? That I felt connected with that raw, awesome power of nature. Quick vocabulary, key vocabulary. Wave, yeah? A wave. This is the noun for the big hump, the big hill of water that you stand on with your surfboard, yeah, that comes into the shore. A wave. Surfing the waves was also a way to show off social status. The better you were at catching waves, the more respect you earned from your peers. In some cultures, the best warrior, the best soldier would get the most respect. But in these Polynesian cultures, you'd also get sincere respect for being a good surfer. Did you know that Hawaiian chiefs would surf to show their people how brave and skilled they were? Yeah, a chief's ability to surf was apparently just as important as their ability to lead. So next time you're impressed by a politician's speech, you know, you can ask, yeah, but can they surf? Next, How did surfing go from Polynesia to the Western world? I mean, nowadays it's so popular in Australia, South Africa, America, Portugal, Bali, yeah? I mean, it's a big part of the identity of these places. Captain Cook was one of the most famous British explorers in many hundreds of years ago. He sailed a lot through the Pacific Ocean, and it was he who mapped and charted Australia, the first European to visit the east side of Australia, as well as New Zealand, and was the first European to discover the Hawaiian Islands. These explorers saw Hawaiians riding waves in the 18th century and thought, whoa, like, what is this magical sport? When Western explorers first tried to describe surfing to their mates back home, there were some funny miscommunications. One explorer described it as wave sliding and compared it to riding a sleigh on snow. So I can picture their friends in England scratching their heads and saying, you mean they're riding waves, like in the ocean, like on wooden planks? What? Like, what? You know, just seems crazy. Hawaiian royalty meaning the kings and queens of Hawaii, also played an important role in popularizing surfing too. In the early 20th century, a Hawaiian prince named, right, I can't say Hawaiian names, Jonah Kuhio Kalanayanole, and his brothers introduced surfing to America. Californians and Australians especially fell in love with the sport. When surfboards first arrived in Australia, Australians thought they looked like giant pieces of cheese. So they started calling them cheeseboards. Cheeseboards was the name for a surfboard in Australia for a little while. As surfing gained popularity, surfboards began to evolve and change and improve. Yeah, evolve means to change, to improve, yeah? To change shape. The first boards were heavy, big pieces of wood, but they evolved into more lighter and more agile, more high-tech boards, so then more was possible in the waves. New lightweight and fiberglass designs could help surfers carve up waves like a hot knife through butter. The first surf film, The Endless Summer from 1966, was the start of surfing becoming a mainstream meaning popularized. This important movie greatly helped surfing become mainstream in Western pop culture. It's a beautiful movie that showed surfing around the world and inspired young surfers to travel the world to find waves, not just in their own back garden, but also around the world. So this movie, Endless Summer, followed two surfers on a quest, on a journey to find the perfect wave. The film's budget was so low, they couldn't afford a real soundtrack, apparently. So for the music, they just played the same song again and again and again on repeat. As surfboards evolved, so did the sport. Surfers started getting more daring, trying out new tricks and pushing the limits on what's physically possible. A funny side note, some people even tried riding on ironing boards. Yeah, you heard that right. Ironing boards that you normally use to iron your clothes. So they tried to surf on ironing boards. In a nutshell, the 20th century surfing boom transformed the sport into a global, worldwide phenomenon and also a cultural movement. Surfing captured the hearts and minds of people everywhere. Within surfing, surfers have their own clothing styles, and even their own beliefs and ethos, and even their own language. There are many surfing English slang terms that we hear nowadays. I'll tell you about them later. The first surf competition The first surf contest was held in 1928 in Corona del Mar in California. They called it the Pacific Coast Surfing Ride Championships, and it was a whole new level at the time. Surfers had to impress judges with their wave riding skills, style, and of course their ability to stay on the board. Nowadays, you even have dog surfing championships. The Dog Surf Championships. That's right, dogs on surfboards. These are, you know, our furry friends here. They actually catch waves better than many humans. Actually, they can often stay on a board better than me, like completely honestly. Once you get the dog on the board, it's able to stay on it quite easily. Probably similar to how, like here in Hanoi in Vietnam, people just put their dogs on the bike seat just behind them and they drive and the dog perfectly stands there on four legs. And actually, they have a dog surfing competition in my hometown in the UK, in Bournemouth. They have this, no joke. Once per year, they have this dog surfing championship. But it's like a day out for the family, right? There's lots of different events and music and bands and crafts and games for the kids. It's more like a day of fun. So surfing isn't just about skill and athleticism, but also about having fun and embracing the joy of the waves. And it's so healthy for you. That's what first attracted me to it. It's a full body workout. Every part of your body is exercised. This is why I first started it, because I hate going to the gym. I need an activity where my mind is occupied, yeah? A game of strategy that I can continuously improve at. Now I'm back living in Hanoi City in Vietnam. I'm back, I'm playing football, yeah? Actually, for these same reasons, because it's more interesting for my mind than just going to the gym. But I do miss surfing, yeah? If you could try it, like I definitely suggest it. So, surfing developed its own fascinating subculture of surfing as well. The subculture includes its own unique music and fashion to the amusing stereotypes and slang, yeah? So, Surf music, you might have heard the Beach Boys before. They're very famous in the 60s. If you know the Beatles, you might know the Beach Boys. In the 1960s, we first had surf music, which is like catchy tunes and electric guitars, creating the perfect soundtrack for riding waves. Bands like the Beach Boys and the Ventures brought that beachy vibe to the mainstream. Now let's talk fashion. Surf fashion is all about keeping it casual and comfortable. Big baggy clothes, comfortable, yeah. Board shorts, tops and flip-flops. The essential uniform of a true surfer. And don't forget the iconic Hawaiian shirts, yeah? Which can turn any gathering or party into a beach party. Do you have any Hawaiian shirts? You know, shirts with lots of flowers on them, or, you know, like all kinds of designs, different kinds of flowers and different like kinds of fish and water and palm trees and these kinds of things. To be honest, I wear Hawaiian shirts to work most days at my school. Yeah, I'm that guy, that kind of teacher. And to be honest, half of my department wear Hawaiian shirts nowadays. It kind of caught on. And we live in Southeast Asia, right? So every day is quite hot. So it just goes with the whole kind of atmosphere here. So yeah, with the big psychedelic designs. It's something fun for the kids maybe, because you know, the Vietnamese and Korean teachers don't dress that way. So we're like the weird foreigners that do wear Hawaiian shirts. Surfers also have their fair share of stereotypes, right? Like, what's the cliche surfer? When you think of a surfer, well, I think, what do you think of the cliche, the stereotype? When I think of a surfer, I think Australian or Californian. Blonde hair, which is tangled and not brushed. Burnt, red skin or deeply tanned. Always laid back.
Yeah.
Chilled. Quite relaxed. Speaking like this. It's like, hey, bro. Did you check out the waves? Did you see the swell yesterday morning? So it's a quite bad impression, but they kind of speak quite slowly.
Yeah.
It's the stereotype. And while some surfers might fit that stereotype, most actually aren't during the week. During the week, they can be doctors, lawyers, accountants. Anyone can be a secret surfer nowadays. So the surf slang, yeah? Surf words that we now use in our everyday language, especially adjectives and verbs, like gnarly, shred, stoked. Surfers, they have a language of their own. I mean, these examples are in everyday conversation. For example, stoked, yeah? Americans especially say stoked. An adjective is one you can use meaning to be excited or euphoric. When I caught that wave, I was so stoked. But you can also say it outside the context of surfing, and many people do, yeah? You can also say, like, I'm stoked to be on the team, or when I got my new guitar, I was so stoked. Synonym, yeah, for amazed, super excited. Surfing, as you can imagine, being something that's outside of the mainstream. Remember, mainstream meaning what the majority of people like. Alternative is the opposite. For example, alternative music, mainstream music. You know, like mainstream music is like top 10 pop songs. Mainstream. Back to what I was saying. So because surfing is traditionally outside of the mainstream, more alternative, there are all kinds of eccentric and interesting characters that have found fame surfing, riding the waves. Okay, classic characters. First up, we have the legendary Duke Kahanamoku, born in Hawaii in 1890. There are pictures of him surfing in 1912, the earliest photo I could find with a huge board, 1912, so over 100 years ago. Duke was a true pioneer of modern surfing. He won Olympic gold in swimming, but also introduced surfing to the world. Fun fact, Duke once saved 8 people. Once saved the lives of 8 people from a boat that had capsized using only his surfboard. Talk about a real-life superhero. So the boat was capsized, meaning it had turned upside down, and he saved people from the capsized boat just using his surfboard. Next, we have Mikadora, also known as the Black Knight of surfing. Miki was known for his rebellious attitude and crazy, epic surf skills. This guy became a notorious, a dangerous bank robber later in life. I guess he wanted to ride the wave of crime, too. Maybe, just maybe, the great movie Point Break, featuring Keanu Reeves and Patrick Swayze, yeah, about the surfer bank robbers. Maybe it's based on Mikadora in some way. I'm not sure if you've seen this movie, but the original from 1991 is an absolute classic. Surfers that rob banks wearing the rubber masks of dead presidents. The next character we'll examine is the amazing Gidget, the original surfer girl. Gidget, whose real name was Kathy Kona, inspired a whole generation of female surfers. She even had a movie and TV show based on her life. Gidget showed that girls can shred waves just as well as the boys. And in my opinion, look better and more fabulous whilst doing it. And did you know there was a famous, well, there is a famous one-armed surfer, a surfer with one arm. And maybe you can guess why she had one arm. A shark attack. It's true. A shark. A tiger shark, to be exact. one of the most aggressive sharks. The tiger shark bit her arm off while she was surfing. And there are some amazing short documentaries on Bethany Hamilton and her story. But did you know she was a professional surfer? And she still is a professional surfer with just one arm, entering and winning major competitions with one arm, still today. That's amazing. That means A, paddling out to the water, B, pushing the board and ducking under the waves, yeah, just to get out under the waves, to get out there to where the best waves are with one arm. So popping up and standing on the board with one arm. That must be a strong arm, right? They must be one hell of a strong arm. And, well, what does the future hold for this sport of surfing? So we've come a long way from the ancient wooden surfboards of Polynesia to the high-tech, lightweight fiberglass boards of today. Surfing has evolved from a spiritual pastime to a worldwide phenomenon, inspiring a unique subculture filled with music, fashion, and its own slang language. Surfing has also given rise to legendary athletes who've carved their names into history. They've shown us that surfing is more than just a sport. It's a way of life that transcends stereotypes and inspires us to chase our dreams and never stop chasing our dreams, because the next ride, the next wave, can be the best, always. And the waves, my friends, never stop coming. There are infinite opportunities in surfing and in life. Surfing teaches us profound lessons such as patience and a never-ending determination to improve. I remember, let me share with you a beautiful memory in Bali. In Bali, myself and a few friends went surfing, and as beginners, we couldn't get out into the waves. We kept being pushed back again and again by these giant waves. And so we couldn't get out there, yeah? Just these big waves were pushing us back, and we didn't have the strength to get past them so we could ride the waves. And as I was drinking a coconut on the shore, strategizing how to get through the waves, I saw an old man, maybe 75, maybe even 80 years old. He had a long white ponytail, bald head, yeah? Just long hair coming off the back. And it was white as snow. He had a super small board. And I've never seen like an older guy in such amazing shape. He was thin, but you could also see a natural six-pack. And he was muscular, yeah? He got on his super small board, just on his knees, which is very hard to balance, by the way, to just be on your knees on a super small board. And he made it look so easy. And he gently glided out, and he got past the waves that we couldn't get past. He got past the big white, you know, waves. He got past them in just 2 or 3 minutes, just like gently paddling out with his hands, maybe less than 2 or 3 minutes. It was effortless for him. He looked so relaxed. This man was at one with the water. There was something otherworldly, maybe even godly, about this man. And he rode just a few waves, and he was out there for maybe 20 minutes, and it all looked so easy. It was an effortless dance between him and the waves. There was a connection between the two. And he rowed back to the shore. He picked up his board and he walked back into the palm trees where he had originally come from. Walked back into the palm trees, never to be seen again. Did I imagine it? I don't know. I thought in that moment, that is one of the most pure and natural and most beautiful things I've ever seen with these two eyes. That man is the most successful person I've ever seen. Maybe life is a beach. And maybe the waves are the various events and experiences. Sometimes our technique and the ride is perfect. And other times it's not, but we try anyways. And sometimes when we fall, we get back up. Try again. And sometimes we don't. Ooh, deep. Think about that one. Okay, guys. I'm thinking about it. Remember to do the worksheet. Yeah, it's all about surfing on simpleenglishlistening.com. Enjoy it. Give us a subscribe, leave us a review, a comment, blah, blah, blah. And it's been lovely to have this moment of sharing with you all. And pleasure as always, my dear, beloved, dear, darling listeners. So see you next time. And see you on the 1st of next month for another sharing of knowledge and beautiful learnings. Okay, goodbye.